France boasts the largest number of Basset hounds, from small to large-sized. The Bassets can be defined as the smaller cousins of the large-sized hounds, deliberately bred, often mixing a mutation that is introduced in the litters as a definitive characteristic to produce dogs that can get into animal lairs and thick undergrowth without problems. There are six Bassets from France: the Norman Artesian Basset, the Basset Bleu de Gascogne, the Grand and the Petit Griffon Vendine, the Artoise Basset and the Basset Fauve de Bretagne, all of which take their names from the regions in the northwest of France on the Atlantic Ocean. This area is very important historically, agriculturally, and from an animal husbandry point of view, since there are many sheep farms. The Fauve Basset is one of the most numerous dogs in France. There are often over 1,000 registrations a year. The numbers have increased in the last 20 years thanks to the prestigious results achieved in the French Cup. In Italy too, the Basset has the largest number of dogs registered in the pedigree books, although it cannot compete with the more famous Basset Hound, which is of Anglo-Saxon origin. Its history is closely linked to that of the Grand Fauve, which is now extinct, from which came the Griffon Fauve, all characterized, as the name says, by the reddish coat. The origins of the Breton Fauve are controversial, as is often the case with ancient breeds, and this is one of the oldest breeds of hunting dogs. One theory, put forward by the important figure King Charles IX in his book, The Royal Chasse, says that it descends from the St. Louis Grey Dog, which was selected by King Louis IX of France in the 13th century for hunting big game in large packs, such as the wolf. It seems that when the king was released from prison in the Holy Land, he asked for a pack of hounds he had admired hunting deer to take home with him. They later became known as the St. Louis Grey Dog. The other theory is that the Bassets were indigenous and resulted from the crossing of the St. Louis Grey Dog with the King's White Dogs, which in turn were the result of crossbreeding of St. Hubert's dogs with Italian hounds by Francis I after the war with Italy. It is difficult to prove any of these theories. There were certainly famous French hunting dogs before the 15th century with short tawny coats, fauve, and these dogs are probably their descendants. It is known for certain that Anne of Beaujeu, the daughter of Louis IX, owned and bred the Breton Fauve and personally took care of them. She was the owner of a famous dam which bred with one of the king's white dogs. The importance of the Breton Fauve in this period is notable. They were used in packs with great success for their passion in the hunt. Jacques de Foulou, in his essay dated 1652, Traite de Vénérie, was one of the first to describe the Breton Fauve when discussing the training of his dog for fox hunting. The fact that the Breton Fauve was able to stay pure and avoid contamination was unusual at that time. To curb their slightly independent character, it was common to cross them with the white dogs of the king. Thanks must go to the nobles of Breton and their stubborn parochialism, but also to the people who used the Breton hounds to defend their flocks from the wolves. The disappearance of the wolf caused a fall in popularity of the Fauve and other hunting dogs, such as the Griffon Vendine and the Griffon Nivernais. With purity lost, there was a reduction in homogeneity and a risk of deterioration. As the Fauve was no longer being selected to hunt wolves, it began to appear in different sizes according to the job required. The Fauve Basset was selected in this way. It probably started off as a mutation, only selecting the puppies with short legs that were born in a litter, or as a cross with existing Bassets, such as the Griffon Vendine Basset. The fact that other Bassets valued for their hunting skills on the ground already existed made it difficult for the Breton Fauve. Immediately after the First World War, a Breton breeder, Monsieur Tutel, was one of the first to appreciate the breed, and he collaborated on the first layout of the standard in 1921. Yet the Fauve Basset ran the risk of extinction also because the hunters preferred to use other breeds, as its reddish coat was too similar to that of many wild animals. Only at the end of the Second World War, in 1949, did the breed find a real savior in Marcel Pinbrun, president of the Société Canine Bretonne. He, along with Jean de Pluvier, created the Briquette Fauve de Bretagne Club. It is thanks to him that we owe the rebirth in quality breeding, crossing it not only with Griffon Vendine Basset, but also with rough-haired Bassets. Nowadays, the breed can be considered to have started in the 19th century. The Breton Fauve Basset is a typical Basset, faster but with a more compact trunk than other French Bassets. It is very adaptable, even to apartment life, with its vivacious character, and if accustomed when still young, may live with other animals such as cats and small rabbits without any problems. Because of its innate pack instinct, it has no problems living with other dogs. It is a lovable and charming dog, not in the least aggressive, that endears itself to all members of the family and constantly looks for affection. It is sociable and well-balanced. With children, it cannot wait to become a real playmate and has a lot of patience. It has, however, inherited defects from its progenitor, the Grand Breton Fauve. Besides being a rustic and robust dog, it is also a little stubborn and very independent. Like all stubborn, independent dogs, it does not obey out of fear, but only if it esteems and respects its master. Its particular character requires a certain authority during early training. Its coat is hard and rough and does not require clipping or excessive treatments. It only needs a regular brush, above all when molting, and a bath only when necessary. Although it can adapt to city life, the Fauve Basset is a sturdy hunting dog with lots of energy and initiative, even if it cannot compete in speed with longer-legged gun dogs. It has an excellent sense of smell. It can exploit the tracks and follow them until it finds the game. It is not afraid of the more difficult terrain with tangled and thick undergrowth, and it is mainly used in large packs for hunting rabbits, but it has become multi-purpose, valued today for hunting hares, big game, drag hunting and den hunting. General appearance. As far as the features of the head, the texture and colour of the coat and the gait are concerned, it resembles the breed from which it originated, i.e. the Grand Fauve of Breton. It is used to hunt in thick vegetation and in tight dens, where a small animal is necessary, lively and compact, in keeping with the look of the Basset. Its height at the withers is between 32 centimetres to 38 centimetres, with a tolerance of more or less 2 centimetres for subjects of exceptional quality. It is courageous, wily and obstinate. Its gait is quite fast compared to its size. The coat is harsh, rough, rather short and never woolly or curly. The face should not be bushy. It is fawn in colour, the better tones being from golden wheaten to brick red, and it sometimes has a white star on its chest, although this is not sought after. The skull is rather long, with marked occipital protuberance. The front line of the skull should form a flattened arch, narrows from the rear to the eyebrow arches, which are not very prominent. The muzzle is long, slightly tapering. The stop is a little more pronounced than in the Griffon Fauve de Bretagne. The cheeks are quite prominent. The nose is black or dark brown with well-open nostrils. The lively eyes are dark brown and the conjunctiva is hidden. The ears are finely attached in line with the eye, just reaching the point of the nose when drawn forward, ending in a point, turned inwards and covered by finer and shorter hair than on the rest of the body. The forelegs have slanting shoulders. The limbs are perpendicular and strong, straight or slightly twisted. The hind legs have muscular thighs which are perpendicular with slightly angled hocks. The toes are close together. The chest is wide and high with quite round ribs. The back is short and wide. The loins are high, wide and very muscular. The abdomen is slightly raised. The tail is like a saber, large at the base, thick and pointed, tapering towards the tip. In action, it moves from side to side. The following are considered faults: a weak and delicate aspect, a skull too wide or too narrow, eyebrows too pronounced, a pointed or short face, the ears either too short, too long, attached too low, flattened or covered with curly hair, the thighs too round, wide and floppy feet, the back too long, an abdomen too raised, coat with scorching or with unwanted white. In spite of our uncertainty about the origins of the Bassets, it is likely that the Basset Hound is related to the great hound breeds, and except for the length of the legs, the look and certain talents, such as the sense of smell and the voice, are similar. Yet little has been written about this dog with short legs since the 19th century. Bassets already existed in prehistory. In fact, in the prehistoric cave of Calmette near Vence in the Maritime Alps, Basset remains have been identified amongst other remains belonging to bigger dogs. Rock paintings which date back 5,000 or 6,000 years show 11 Bassets stopping a wild boar that an archer with a bow arch keeps in his sights. In a valuable book in English, dealing with the Basset Hound, Johnston explains that some mural paintings in Egyptian graves show that these little strange dogs had already been discovered. A painting found in the tombs at Beni Hassan, 2200 to 2000 BC, shows a group of thin and elegant dogs, accompanied by a little dog with short but straight legs. This shows that this dog had the unique short limbs common to the Bassets. Dogs of the same genus are depicted in the grave of Thotmes II, 2000 BC. According to legend, this dog was the pharaoh's favorite. We do not have many elements with which to map out a historical route for these Bassets, and therefore we cannot draw up any theories. We know that our distant ancestors needed dogs capable of following foxes or badgers into their deep lairs. It is easy to imagine that the Basset, with its very fine sense of smell and its exemplary tenacity, perfectly answered the demands of those hunters. King Modus called them little terrier dogs or ground dogs. The first written documentation that we have on the French Basset refers in fact to this underground work and quotes an extract from a beautiful, oft-reprinted book by Jacques de Foulu, La Vénerie, 1652, The Art of Hunting, dealing with the training of young dogs for hunting fox and badger. Jacques de Foulu is also the first author of the 17th century to describe the Dachshund, pointing out its twofold use: underground as a terrier, on the surface as a bloodhound. In the same work, he maintains that the two types of Basset are originally from Flanders, a theory that is no longer widely agreed on. In fact, these two Bassets could have come from the Vendée or from Great Britain. It would seem more logical, however, to consider, both from appearance and character, that the Basset with rough hair described by Foulu comes from the Vendée and Breton dogs, which are nowadays always marked by these characteristics. Other kinds of dog are linked to the evolution of hunting. For example, the Saint Hubert was used in France at the time of the Crusades as a hunting hound. It was a slow and heavy-set dog, very unlike that which we know today. The knights of the Crusades brought back from their trips leaner, lighter, and therefore quicker horses. The slow Saint Hubert became useless, unable as it was to follow the horses. The Crusaders also brought greyhounds with them, and shortly small Saint Hubert dogs with rolled tails appeared, the first sign of crossbreeding with greyhounds. The style of the dog was modified. The hound gained speed and elegance, but to the detriment of its sense of smell, which it miraculously found again later on. The work of Jacques Dufoulieu in the 17th century and of Buffon in the 18th century shows the continued existence of the Bassets, although these dogs were not known outside a narrow circle. Without the intervention of Monsieur le Culteur de Canteleur, master hunter and breeder, who in 1860 was the first to show a true interest in these small dogs, the Basset would have been forgotten. The Basset is a dog of lowland areas, but every region possesses its own breed of Bassets, with precise characteristics linked to the particular regions. In the Artois, a region not without hills, the dogs are heavy, stocky, and slower. In Great Britain and Vendée, the dog's hair is rougher and protects it against water and thorns, and its character is strong and stubborn. Every region had its indigenous breed of Bassets, but differences are still found in the regional breeds. Indeed, every breeder, who is nearly always a hunter, breeds in accordance to their own personal ideas and in accordance with the real use of the dogs for hunting. Nevertheless, from 1860 onwards, the idea of the breed made progress and dog lovers started to speak about the dogs and organize shows. The first show took place in London in 1861. The first true show in France in 1863. That year, a world show where 850 dogs participated was organized in the woods of Boulogne. The shows had a very particular influence on the improvement in the canine species, and knowledge of this breed spread all over Europe. It is a dog of rare intelligence with a captivating nature. Its ardor, tenacity, the willingness to take the strain, compared to its slow gait, make an irreplaceable friend for the solitary wandering hunter. This animal lives the greatest part of its time near to its trainer owner. It possesses all that it needs to create a fondness between them, and it conquers the house as well as taking part in the children's games. It is not only talented at hunting, but it also has a sweet and subdued character. The Basset Arcien Normand has a look and an appeal that captures the sympathy of the hunters. Yet if our Basset can be universally considered a hunting dog, often chasing hare, roe deer and also wild boar, its vocation remains that of chasing rabbits. The Basset's talent of chasing are summarized in its fine sense of smell and its gait. Rather slow but regular, and with good reason, it has been nicknamed the Little Hunting Tenor. It loves two things, faithfully following the tracks and filling the wood with its powerful and harmonious voice. The dog will not lead the way in rediscovering the far-off tracks of the game, but very slowly it forces itself, taking all the time that is needed, but in the end always finding the game. To effectively chase rabbits, you do not need a rapid dog, but a workman who sticks to the trail. It must chase courageously, it must not bark without reason or be too silent. In these conditions, the rabbit does not remain hidden long, and feeling that its tracks have again been followed with tenacity and without stumbling, it will surely look to escape. This proves that hunting the quarry with hounds is not as simple as it seems. For this kind of hunting, the stature of the dog has a certain importance. We must remember that the Basset is a dog that hunts in a pack. When the young dogs reach 18 months, it is necessary to teach them how to behave themselves. It is advisable to take two adult dogs that are used to hunting together and which are calm and good workers. Release them, and when they have begun the search and found the right trail, release a young dog which will join them and quickly understand what to do. One young dog should be introduced into the group at a time. Only when this last dog behaves well and hunts effectively with its companions can you start with another young dog, and so on. The better young dogs will be introduced to the pack first, followed by the less precocious ones. For the young dogs, the group work will simplify many things. The dogs judge themselves. The weaker dogs will get confidence from contact with the stronger and will regulate their walk to them, contributing their own din to the group. The Bassets used for hunting with a rifle must get used to the noise as soon as possible. General appearance. A long dog, as long as its height allows, sturdy and well-built, as becomes a great breed, bloodhounds. Head, domed, medium-large, with well-shaped jowls, not as muscular as a bulldog, but with one or two folds in the skin. Overall, the head must be lean. Nose, large and black, jutting slightly over the lips, open nostrils. Muzzle, medium long, fairly wide, slightly convex before the nose. Skull, marked ridge, occiput often well marked. Eyes, large, dark, calm and serious expression, at times the horse shows. Ears, set as low as possible, but above the line of the eye, narrow at the top, twisting, flexible, thin, very long, reaching at least the tip of the muzzle and ending in points. Neck, fairly long, with a slight jowl, not too heavy. Shoulders, rounded, strong and short with good muscling. Forelegs, short, solid, very heavy, standing out to some extent, visible torsion but never pigeon-toed. Often there are folds of skin on the front pasterns. Feet, straight, the toes must be well-shaped and rest firmly on the ground. The Basset Artesien must leave footprints in snow or soft ground that are similar to a large dog. Chest, rising sternum, fairly low chest, never wide or rounded. Ribcage, rounded, which compensates for lack of depth. Back, wide and well muscled. Croup, slightly raised. Rump, sloping and full. Loins, slightly sloping and muscular, they must form an almost spherical mass with the rump. Hocks, slightly bent, strong, often with one or two folds of skin, as on the forelegs, and at the tip of the heels there may be a slight rise formed by the folded skin. Tail, well set, rather long, strong at the base, tapering towards the tip. Carried sabre-like, but never falling over the back, and never curly. It is absolutely forbidden to handle the tail of a dog in the ring. Colour, tricolour, white and orange bicolour. The tricoloured dog must have mainly tan markings on the head, with a marked coat, whether black hair or badger coloured, providing the tips are tan. Coat, short and dense, not too fine. Height, from 26 to 36 centimetres at the withers. Gait, calm but free.
A proper diet is essential to your dog's correct and full development so as to be able to keep it in perfect shape and health. Some people believe that dogs can eat virtually anything and therefore give their dogs all kinds of food, often recycling the leftovers from their own meals. This is a serious mistake, since what may be digestible to us and a source of nourishing substances often cannot be digested by dogs or is unable to be metabolized. A final piece of advice. It sometimes happens that a dog loses its appetite and refuses food for one or even 2 days. This is a normal occurrence, and in these cases it is a good rule not to always leave a full bowl of food down for the dogs. Instead, the food should be removed after a short time. Present the bowl of food again at the following mealtime after having changed its contents. In the event of loss of appetite lasting for more than 2 days without the presence of side symptoms, or if it is accompanied from the outset by symptoms of general suffering or exhaustion, consult your vet immediately. It is very likely to be an ordinary ailment, but in this case it is not worth taking a risk, and it is better to seek reassurance from an expert. We will now begin with a brief description of a dog's digestive apparatus. As in all carnivores, the stomach is of large dimensions, whereas the intestine is relatively short. Initial digestion in the stomach takes from 3 to 8 hours, then the food passes into the intestine where the nourishing substances are assimilated, which are then transmitted to all the organs through the blood. The stomach's large capacity and the slow digestion process allow abundant meals to be eaten at fairly spaced out intervals. Naturally, to keep dogs in excellent health, it is necessary to provide them with all the elements that they require, that is, proteins, carbohydrates, fats, vitamins, and minerals. When dogs were carnivorous predators, these elements were assimilated by dogs through the animals that they hunted, and which were generally herbivores. Afterwards, civilization has led it to feed differently, but it will always be necessary to provide dogs with the appropriate substances. Dogs produce energy from their diet, which is then used for the maintenance of vital functions and movement. The more active a dog is, the greater the energy intake it will require. Without going into detailed food studies that would require a specific treatise, we can simply say that dogs particularly require fats or lipids, both of animal and vegetable origin, and it is these which provide the necessary energy and which accumulate in the organism to provide possible energy reserves. The proteins that make up the large part of the animal's body are also essential. These are indispensable to the formation of all the tissues, especially muscles, and also constitute the basis of hormones and the blood. They therefore represent an irreplaceable element in a proper diet, even more so in puppies, which must build their bodies. Sources of protein are meat, cheese, eggs, and fish, which are well digested by dogs, and also soybean flour, peanuts, legumes, which are, however, digested with more difficulty. An excess of proteins is harmful and can lead to various kinds of disorders, depending on the conditions. Carbohydrates are not essential to a dog's diet. They are, however, very useful at the end of pregnancy. Starch, which is the most important carbohydrate present in the diet, is poorly digested by dogs and needs to undergo preliminary treatment such as cooking, flaking, etc. This is why if you use pasta or rice as a food for your canine friend, it needs to be boiled for a long time to eliminate a large part of the starch present. Fiber, which often accompanies carbohydrates, is especially useful in the diet of sedentary dogs, since it helps to prevent constipation, given the speed with which it passes through the alimentary tract. Vitamins are also necessary, even if in infinitesimal amounts. They are found in many vegetables and are synthesized by herbivorous animals. This is the reason why when a carnivore kills its prey, generally herbivorous, it immediately feeds on the intestines, where there are residues of partially digested vegetable matter. This also explains why, to your considerable annoyance, your dog often eats the excrement of herbivorous animals as soon as it gets the chance. A buildup of vitamins can be harmful, and therefore, if you use pre-prepared feed, you should carefully check the substances contained in the feed before adding supplements, and if in doubt, consult your vet. Minerals are essential to the diet and are supplied by foods. Deficiency in certain minerals such as calcium, iron, potassium, sodium, copper, and others can cause abnormal growth in puppies, also with serious consequences and general debility in adult dogs, or the onset of problems of varying degrees. There is excellent pre-packed feed on the market, both moist and dry types, that provide all the necessary elements for initial growth and to then keep your dog in top shape. Even if you use pre-packed feed, you will, however, be able to give some fruit or other food which your dog will find tasty, taking care not to exaggerate and not to give harmful substances such as sweets, fried foods, rice dishes, fresh or soft doughy bread that are extremely harmful and which can also have very serious long-term consequences. Instead, if you want to prepare the food yourself, then follow the advice of the breeder who sold you the dog or your vet's advice. As a general rule, it is worth knowing that meat, ideally beef, is essential. If pork meat is given, it must be well cooked in order to avoid infections. Poultry, meat and rabbit are also fine, provided that they are completely boneless. Giblets, although less rich in nourishing substances, are well liked. Fish is an excellent food and is best given cooked. It is particularly advisable for low-fat diets for dogs with digestive or skin problems. It is also an excellent means with which to make the diet less monotonous. Eggs are appetizing and supply many nourishing substances. They are particularly advisable for puppies and suckling females. Yolks can be consumed raw, whereas the albumen should always be cooked. Fats, such as lard and oil, are always readily accepted by dogs and are particularly useful during moments of work or physical effort. 1 or 2 teaspoonfuls of oil added to food are always beneficial. Dry bread is a good energy source, but it must be well dried. It is also useful for cleaning your dog's teeth and for keeping them in good condition. Pasta and rice are very useful, but as we have already said, they should be cooked very well to eliminate starch, which is not easily digested. Fruit and vegetables, even if not essential, can be given to dogs that appreciate them. However, the nutritional intake is very slight and is only worthy of note for the intake of roughage. Needless to say, the final element which is essential to nutrition is water. Fresh and plentiful, that must be available at all times. If in a bowl, it should be changed as often as possible, especially during hot spells. It is absolutely indispensable to dogs that eat dry and not moistened feed. The final aspect of the diet to take into consideration is the frequency of meals. From birth, puppies have their meals by following times that are spaced out by the instinct of the mother and the other siblings in the litter. The feeds are gradually reduced during weaning and are integrated with suitable foods that should be recommended by an experienced breeder or a vet. Between 1 and 3 months of age, weaned puppies should have 4 meals at regular intervals. From 4 to 7 or 8 months, the number of meals can be reduced to 3, further reduced to 2 meals at 8 to 18 months, and afterwards, if desired, down to just 1 meal a day, even if it is not harmful to continue with 2. On the contrary, this is recommended by certain individuals. The decision to have a dog is an important one to make, which must be thought over carefully without ignoring some useful basic information. The vaccination prophylaxis must always be carried out with utmost care to try and protect not only the puppies but also adult dogs from the most common illnesses. Generally speaking, a puppy leaves the breeder after having been vaccinated at around 40 to 45 days with a triad vaccine against canine distemper, infectious hepatitis, and parvovirus. A second quadrivalent vaccination, also including leptospirosis as well as the 3 ailments already mentioned, is generally carried out after 3 weeks. An additional vaccination can be carried out after a month, again quadrivalent, to be then replaced annually throughout the dog's lifespan. A dog can be vaccinated only if it is in perfect health and thus also free from endoparasites. Appropriate antihelminthic treatment must be carried out normally twice a year. Different types of Ascarids exist, each of which specifically infests an animal species, man included, and there is practically no risk of zoonosis, that is, transmission of the infestation from dog to man. It is important that dogs are also kept free from ectoparasites, that is, those that live on dogs such as fleas and mites, both of which are hematophages. Moreover, fleas act as an intermediate host for a type of taenia. Numerous specific products exist to free dogs from these annoying parasites, but one must not forget to also carry out appropriate disinfesting operations in the areas where dogs live. The arrival of spring exacerbates the problems caused by undesired guests, the mites that arrive along with the initial spring warmth. A run in the meadows through woods, perhaps near groups of farmhouses and farms where there is livestock, can result in our canine friend returning home with mites. Not necessarily, since some factors may exist which make a dog more or less susceptible, also depending on its general state of health, that can influence whether or not a dog will pick up these acari. They represent a grave danger to dogs because they transmit pyroplasmosis, a serious infection carried by protozoa of the pyroplasma species that affects pets and also causes death if not discovered and treated in time. The symptoms in its acute form are represented by fever, also sthenic, asthenia, pallor of the apparent mucous membranes, and hyperchromia of the urine that can also become brown-black in color. In advanced cases, jaundice and a comatose state, which could possibly result in death. The mites suck blood for 2 or 3 weeks, and once having mated, the female then detaches itself from the animal and deposits the eggs a week later. The deposited larvae, recognizable by their reddish color, are minute, like tiny beads. They also look for a host on which to climb, sucking blood for several days. They then detach themselves and after a few days change into octopede nymphs of bluish colour. They become adults towards August or September. With the arrival of autumn, the adults immediately upon hatching then lay dormant in cracks in the ground until the next spring. In general, the mites attach themselves to less thick skin, such as ears, armpits, groin, between the digits of the paws. Therefore, as a precautionary measure, we should always examine our canine friends for signs of any undesired guests after a walk in the open. Correct dog hygiene starts with coat care. For most breeds, but not all, it is advisable to brush the coat almost daily in order to remove the hairs that have reached the end of their life cycle. The coat of many breeds requires specialized grooming, which is to be carried out several times a year. One must not generalize about the fact that a shiny coat is a sign of good health, since in some breeds it should have a tendency to be dull. Dogs must not be washed too often so as not to damage the protective function of the sebaceous glands. The skin in normal conditions should always look clean without dandruff deposits or desquamations of any kind. Should cutaneous alterations appear, such as eczema, alopecic areas, i.e. hair loss and failure of hair regrowth, thickening or the appearance of abnormal pigmentation, consult your vet without delay. Cutaneous alterations due to mycosis or mange are spread by contagion, but only in the case of particularly debilitated animals and when one fails to observe the most basic hygienic rules. Claws must also be checked periodically. These are normally worn down in dogs that undergo normal physical activities, but it may be necessary to shorten them with the aid of a special tool. Oral hygiene should never be overlooked, and especially in miniature breeds, tartar removal is necessary from time to time because it can cause pyorrhea and bad breath. Certain bones are available on the market that, besides constituting a treat for our four-legged friend, act as a natural toothbrush. In puppies aged between 4 and 6 months, the deciduous dentition is gradually replaced by the permanent one. Regular inspections of the mouth are advisable during this period to check that everything is okay. The existence of cardiopulmonary filariasis, a serious disease caused by a nematode parasite, Dirofilaria imitis, or the blood and heart, has been known for several centuries, as has been known the important transmission mechanism of the disease by the mosquito for about a century. However, it is only in the last 20 years, due to the rapid diffusion of filariasis in dogs kept for company and work dogs, that research institutes, pharmaceutical companies and vets have paid increasing attention to the problem. It is therefore important that dog owners are also aware, even if in general terms, of the existence and phenomena of the parasitosis. The transmission of the disease occurs through the mosquito's sting, which takes up the filaria larvae by sucking blood from an infected subject to then inoculate them into another healthy dog. The high contagiousness of the parasitosis is therefore easily understandable, in addition to its seasonality, spring-summer. During a period of around 6 months, the larvae in the dog's blood grow into adult worms that are situated in the heart and pulmonary arteries. In turn, the adult filariae produce small larvae called microfilariae, which will live in the blood. The dogs most affected are obviously those that spend more or less long periods outside, hence gun dogs, work dogs, and those that sleep in the open. The damage induced by the presence of the filariae is of considerable seriousness for that which concerns the cardiocirculatory function, and initially shown as a tendency for dogs to tire easily and the presence of a cough or respiratory dysfunction. The vet giving treatment at this stage will perform different clinical and laboratory tests that will confirm the presence of the parasites. On the contrary, the damage caused by chronic cardiopulmonary filariasis is extremely serious. The alteration of the cardiocirculatory function is often accompanied by liver and kidney lesions and a state of generalized hypersensitivity in the whole organism. The prevention programs that have only been practicable for a few years thanks to the use of specific new drugs are simple to carry out and do not involve toxicity risks for dogs. After having carried out a test to ensure the absence of a previous infestation, the oral administration of a medicine once a month for the duration of the entire hot season will give dogs effective protection, also if they are stung by an infected mosquito.